to them. All right, how about you, sisters, not the brothers, service on it?
Very good.
Yes, did a good job.
Excellent job.
But not good enough.
Is there what there? Is there any nonsense? Some competition, but. Next time, I got a possible principal, Brianna, and what we're gonna do is get all of the brothers that can sing together and get her to train the voices a little bit. Bring in those young guys that can sing, you know, everybody go to Brown School, that was maybe, Deborah Brown School.
Oh, yeah.
Everybody go there, they can sing.
Yeah.
They're right there, everybody go there. So we're gonna have the young brothers to join them. Yeah, we'll probably have about eight brothers. Brother Wayne, he's got a good boy up here, he can sing. He sang, Brother Wayne? You ever try it? Huh?
I enjoy it.
Yeah. We forgot to ask me, but I got to tell him to say. So what's one of the men singing?
Forgot who?
He forgot me.
Oh, you.
I guarantee you one thing, I would have been her. I would have drowned them out. I would have caused them to.
They did a good job.
Your brother Travis, she did a great job. All the
brothers
that spoke.
All the
singers. Yeah, brother Travis, he could have gone as long as I would.
Brother Travis can sing.
Yeah, brother Travis can sing.
Yeah.
Wow.
Turn your mic up.
Okay.
What? It just goes.
All in one.
See, and I just go.
Okay, I want to start out kind of light. The purpose, the purpose scripture, I don't think I've given you all of them under the heading, the purpose of our walk with the Lord, the purpose of being called to the kingdom. I got some of these scriptures, in fact, I got one of them today. I think that Colossians 1:9 reflects the main purpose, and I'm going to give you St. John 15, verses 1 through 10, the main purpose that God created us, that God recreated us, and we always say this, we always say God created us for His glory, for His pleasure, but specifically, we really want to break it down. All of these things that I'm going to mention tonight would be for God's pleasure and for God's glory. Colossians 1:9 states it real well, the main purpose, because when you look at the main purpose that God created us, you can understand why it's the most important purpose that God created us. And He created us according to First Corinthians 1:9. And you want to keep this in mind, that if God created you for that purpose, then you have to answer God for not fulfilling that purpose. So this is a huge issue. Colossians 1:9 says, God is faithful by whom you were called. Corinthians. Okay, well, Colossians 1:19, we can hold it there, but Corinthians 1, all these scriptures, 1:9-10. What is it? Something. 1 Corinthians 1:9-10, then we're going to go Colossians. God is faithful, 1 Corinthians 1:9, by whom ye were called unto the fellowship of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. Now I beseech you, brethren, by the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that ye all speak the same thing, and that there be no divisions among you, but that ye be perfectly joined together in the same mind and in the same judgment. So the main purpose that God called us is for his the main reason is fellowship. Everybody just said fellowship.
Fellowship.
Okay, now when we look at the main reasons why we have children, is it because that we want companions, we want fellowship, we want someone that we can commune with or relate to, that actually is a part of us? That's probably one of the main reasons why we have children, because we want somebody to hug and to kiss and to love and to pamper and to, you know, to really connect with us. And so God created us because he longed for children, someone that we could love and really reflect himself through. And sometimes we get joy when we see our children, think we, you know, have our nose and our voice and our hair. You know, sometimes our feet may come out like one. and the members of our body, you know, because it's just is a reflection of ourselves. So I think that fellowship is the main reason that God created us, because he has someone that he can manifest himself through. And I believe that Paul said it this way in Galatians, someone that, I like the way Paul said it in Galatians. You might want to just turn to Galatians 1. Okay, Galatians 1, this was 15. He says, but when it pleased God, he separated me from my mother's womb and called me by his grace to reveal his Son in me, that I might preach him among the heathen. Immediately I compared not to the flesh and blood, neither would I look to Jerusalem to them which were apostles before me, but I went into Arabia and returned again to Damascus. Then after 3 years I went to Jerusalem to see Peter and abode with him 15 days and so forth and so on. So to reveal his Son in me, to reveal Jesus, and to let people know that God is a good God. Now the virtues that you see that God wants revealed would be the virtues that Brother Travis pointed to Sunday. And he used something up above here that probably that didn't quite hit us until he mentioned it. Now these are the virtues that God wants us to reveal so that people can know what God is like. You can see the verses up there. God is what? Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Those are the fruits of the Spirit, but that those reflect the very nature and character of God. And these are the things that God wants everybody to know about Him. And when people can see these virtues reflected through us, then people know, then will know what God is like. And so God calls us to reveal Jesus to what? To the world. We're the light of the world, right? We're the city that sits on the hill that can't be hid. And we are the salt of the earth. So fellowship is very important, because there's no way we can reflect or project these virtues unless we have an intimate fellowship with the Lord. So that's what we really want to deal with us. And this is the thing that helps us to get established in grace, so that Jesus can be revealed, Jesus can be seen, and He can be projected. You know, how many of you really enjoy seeing an image of your children, projected, an image of you projected through them? Sometimes they act like us and talk like us and do like us and look like us and, and all of that. So we get joy when we see our children reflected. I mean, our virtues, character, amen, projected through them. So that just explains why we were created. We were created in God's image so that we can bring pleasure to Him, so that we will be able to project the character, the nature of God, so people can see that, and then they really want, when they see those virtues projected through us, then they really want to what? To have those same virtues operate in their life. So that shows them that God is what? He's a good God, He's kind, He's a loving God, He's a faithful God, He's a gentle God, He's a God that's what? That can be touched with the feelings of our infirmities. So let's look at St. John 15 and see, when we understand our purpose, that we are to be called into fellowship, and we are to develop an intimate fellowship with Christ. That's our job, worshiping God in the Spirit, rejoicing in Jesus Christ, and having no confidence in our flesh. So it's all about fellowship. If the fellowship is not the objective, then we're not going to be motivated, and we're not going to be fully equipped, because the fellowship determines the extent that you're going to grow and develop and get established in grace. Okay, St. John 15:1. There are other reasons that God created us other than fellowship, but fellowship is the main one, and all of the others hinge on our fellowship, just an outgrowth of our fellowship with the Lord. St. John 15, 1 through 10. I'm just going to read. Do I have one of them loud sisters that can read? Them sisters with them big, strong voices. Thus saith the Lord, I am the true vine, and my Father is the husbandman. I mean, they could really read those things. Every branch in me that beareth not fruit, He taketh away, and every branch that beareth fruit, He purgeth it, that it may bring forth more fruit. Now ye are clean through the word which I have spoken unto you. Abide in me, and I in you, as the branch cannot bear fruit of itself, except it abide in the vine, no more can ye, except ye abide in me. I am the vine, ye are the branches. He that abideth in me, and I in him, the same bringeth forth much fruit, for without me ye can do nothing. If a man abide not in me, he is cast forth as a branch, and is withered, and men gather them, cast them into the fire, and they are burned. If you abide in me and my words abide in you, ye shall ask what ye will, and it shall be done unto you. Herein is my Father glorified, that ye bear much fruit. So shall ye be my disciples. As the branch,
as the Father
hath loved me, so have I loved you. Continue ye in my love. Verse 10, everybody together. If ye keep my commandments, ye shall abide in my love, even as I have kept my Father's commandments. Okay, in that particular portion, abiding in Christ is the fellowship that we're speaking about. And except you abide in Christ, then you cannot really be productive and bear the fruit that God really wants. He tells us to be filled with the fruits of righteousness, to be filled with the fruits of right, bear much fruit. We are called, I believe, in the second chapter of Ephesians, we are his workmanship, created unto good works, that ye what? Everybody should know that. Created unto good works,
which God had
ordained. Okay, which God had what?
Ordained.
Before ordained that we should what?
Walk
in Him. So, God foreordained before the foundation of the world that we would be conformed to His image, so that these good works might be brought forth through us. And so the Bible speaks a whole lot about bearing fruit, being filled with the fruits of righteousness, that we are his workmanship created unto Christ for good works that God has before ordained. So the things that God wants to develop in your life so that you can be very, very fruitful is that we have to abide in his love or keep his commandment. We have to obey. So I think if we had to mention specific purposes, that enumerate the reasons why God created us and what he really expects of us, I think that number one is that we are to what? Abide in him. That means maintain an intimate fellowship with him. An intimate fellowship. Anybody know how you can maintain an intimate fellowship with him? But that's what God wants first. We'll just give y'all a chance to respond to that. How do we abide in him? Because he said if we don't abide in him, then we will not be able to bear fruit and we will be cast forth as a branch. So this is a big issue. God wants us to abide in him. That means maintain a very close fellowship with him. Okay, so how do we do that?
Fellowshiping with him through the word and praying.
Okay, through the word. Good.
Mm-hmm. Take time to be with him. Spend time
in prayer and the word. All right, through the word. Obeying the word, right?
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Being doers of the word and not hearers only. And what else? Obeying. You said that fellowship, obeying.
Right.
And bearing fruit. All of this is mentioned here. Bearing fruit. Okay, when we say bearing fruit, what do we mean? Anybody can just give us what we mean? Because he says that he wants us to bear what? Much fruit. And he wants our fruit that we bear to remain. Okay, so what type of fruit is he talking about? Is he talking about character fruit? Is he talking about fruits of righteousness, which reflects our relationship with people?
I think it's all of them.
I think it's both.
All of it.
Okay, so it would be both, but I think that the fruit that Brother Travis's fruit, he preached from the banner, and this is the character building aspect of our producing our bearing fruits. This is the character aspect, and you can see that as you develop in these attributes or virtues, that it's going to place you in a real powerful position to carry out the other aspect. You know, you're not to do it, well, I'm going to get built up and then I'll begin to minister to people. No, it doesn't work that way. You have to kind of take them along, what, all together. And as you get more knowledge, as you get more established in love, and get more established in grace, these virtues will automatically begin to what? Begin to be what? Displayed or projected through your life. But these virtues will not be projected unless you are actually carrying out the main reasons why God wants us to be believers. We have to really be concerned about the mission and the purpose that God created us. In order to reflect His glory, in order for Christ to be revealed in us, we have to be dead serious about the commission and the reason why Jesus came. He came to what? That we might have what? Life. He came to seek and to save them that are what? Lost. Right? And so if we're to take Jesus' place down here on earth, then we have to have the same motivation, the same zeal, the same purpose. Jesus said that my meat, anybody had a meat today? My meat is to do the will of Him that sent me and to what? Finish His work. And He says, leave it not for the meat that perishes, but for the meat that endureth unto what? Eternal life. So it's kind of important that people really get the meat that they need in order to what? Endure, for it to endure unto what? Eternal life. So that is the little thought that I have, and as you begin to grow in these virtues here, then that means that you're going to really begin to assume your role as taking Jesus' place here on the earth. All right, now suppose, everybody was relegated, 1,000, 100,000 people that you had to be responsible for before you could go to heaven. Okay, you think that you would be a little bit more conscience of the importance of actually getting out and really carrying out that commission. So you, everybody that want to go to heaven, you have to, I don't know how many people we connect with during our lifetime. About how many you think? Three? Two or probably it runs in the hundreds. People that whose path we cross. Probably more than that. So that's our main purpose, is to get established. And whatever the disciplines might be that enable us to be more effective, but God is very interested in us bringing forth what? Much fruit. And He's consistently saying, be filled with the fruit of righteousness. So if we are not moving or traveling in that direction, that we are going to have a lot of regrets, and it's not going to be that abundant entry into the kingdom. And it's kind of hard to conceive the Lord saying, well done, thou what good and faithful servant. So those are the virtues, and they will only be developed as we be true ambassadors. Did I say that right? True ambassadors. Are we ambassadors? We're representing what? Christ, who started the work, and we are to what? Continue, right? And bring it into what? Completion. And when Jesus comes down, then the dispensation of the time frame that God has allowed for this generation will be over. And because everybody that lived in the church age, how many know the church age is the time from Pentecost to the time that Jesus comes back? Everybody in that age will be raptured if they're alive, or they will be raised again from the dead. If all of these people will be judged at the same time. And people that died before Christ, and people that, before Christ, and people that lived during the tribulation period, they will be resurrected at a different time. But this is a very special people. We are a chosen generation. We are a what? Royal priesthood. We are a holy nation. And we're called to show forth the glory of Him who hath what? Called us from darkness into this marvelous light. Okay, so how many feel that carrying the word and ministering the word and helping people, as I said today, we have to really understand that there are a lot of things that we can do to help people. How many have a meditation book? How many have a prayer book? Prayer meeting?
Yes.
Anybody have that?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, now those are some of the things that you can actually share with people. When people first come, that's usually the first thing that we usually try to get into the hands of people that first start coming to church. And when you see people coming into the church, I want you to hear this good, then we really want to begin to show interest. Interest in them. And the first thing that we want to know about them is what now? Okay. The first thing that we definitely want to know about people when they first show up in this church as visitors, what do you think? What do y'all think that should be? Okay. Would you really want to know something about them or the name of the church? Okay. How many, I don't think that we really have to have a special committee, because sometimes what we do, we rely on two or three people to make all of the contacts, to meet them, to get to know them, to call them, and all of that. And I think that as small as we are, as large as we are, as we exist, I think that we could actually try to meet most people. I don't want to stick the women to try to meet, all of the men. But we do have men visiting, right? And we do have what? Women visiting as well. So I think our response would be a lot greater if we would really begin to what? Get to know people. Okay, we're talking about building character, virtues, reflecting Jesus. People want to know if what? Jesus, if that lifestyle is what they want to embrace. And when they can see, look up there and see this through you, how can they see this through you if they don't know you? I guess on Sunday everybody looked like the same. Little down. Hard week I'm going through. Okay. Well, Sister Sharon, Sister Daughter, how do they look when y'all be up there singing to them? I mean, yeah, singing with them.
Disinterested, bored.
Ooh, wait a minute.
Their minds on other things. You just see it all in people's faces. So I've learned to just stop looking. I'm being honest, I've learned that. Because they just, and I'm interested, a lot of them, they're standing there, but you can look at them and tell, they aren't even here.
Okay, now what's up there that pertains to worship up there? What character? See, this is how we win people and how Jesus is reflected. This is the thing that draws people to Christ when they can see these virtues manifested through you. So anything up there pertains to worship on Sunday?
Joy.
All right. Are people okay? Okay. Patience. I'd be for sure glad when this is over.
It's not everybody.
Okay,
but it's enough.
Okay, let's point them out right quick. All right. All right. Okay. Well, people are looking for what? Jesus to be reflected. And if Jesus is reflected, then they're going to be what? Drawn. Mm-hmm. So it's our job to what? To reveal Christ. Paul said he was called from his mother's womb to what? To reveal Christ. And I think that all of us were called. That's the main purpose you were created. What other purpose? Is to work out children and to get material gain. All of that is going to what? Pass away. Only what you do for what? Christ will last. So it seems like to me the most important thing that you could be focused on is to what? Do a good job of revealing Christ, manifesting Christ. And we manifest Christ through virtues. The godly virtues that people see, the godly virtues that motivate us and that enable us to become effective in reaching out to them and helping and blessing them. So there's a lot of things that we have to kind of acclimate our minds to. Because when people first come, I think that it's important for us to what? Befriend them, get to know them. Is there anything wrong with maybe a half a dozen of y'all, a dozen of us, really connecting with people that come? A lot of them probably got some type of need that you can fill.
Yes.
I guarantee you there's something that you can do to help every person that show up. And lest we don't project the image that we got a whole lot of money that we can give them. You can just say that that you know I might not have all of the financial assets that you need, but there are things that I can definitely help you with, and they could be spiritual. Sometimes they could be what? Natural or material. So I think it's a good idea for us to spend a lot more time, because there are people that have visited over and over. There are people that even come. There are people that have started fellowship with us. That they're not going to be consistent because they don't understand the importance of being consistent as a believer. You all have what? Learned that. And you have to what? Communicate that to them on a one-on-one basis. See, there's a lot that people can draw from people that have been established in the things of God. So we have to really begin to, I think the first thing, the most important thing is to learn their names. Write it down, try to remember it, call them, and just talk with them just to build a relationship with them. Well, I guess I'm talking to the choir. Because people are not going to come around like they should unless we play a role in getting them what position where God's grace can look to reach them. We can let them know that it's important for you to come, that you may hear it from me, but it's different when it comes from them. It's important for you to come, what? To come to church. And to be consistent. Name some of the things that we could do to really establish a closer relationship with people and want to and position people to be more committed to come in to hear the word or to come to be a part of this fellowship. What are some of the things we can do?
You have reference to visitors or to inactive members.
Yeah, we can probably put all of them in the same category. Inactive members and also visitors or people, new people that's attended. What are some of the things that we can do? Because I have to learn their names. And, okay, Sister Marion.
Call them when they're absent and tell them that you miss them. I think everybody likes to know they're doing this.
Mm-hmm.
And then that's not just for new people, that's old people as well.
Right. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Okay,
Sister Denise used to call me all the time for when the women were doing something. Mm-hmm. Most of the time I never showed up, but I still wanted her to call. Okay, you quit calling, Sister Denise. I need to start calling again. I was just about to come.
Okay, people like to be called, and I think it's important for us to call people that when they are missed. And I think it's good sometimes to call people when they're not missed. I think everybody needs to be what? Encouraged to be ministered to. I was today talking about my Sister Wayne, who sits right over here, and all of the others that were attending, you know, haven't been here nearly as long as Sister Wayne. And I said that Sister Wayne is probably one that nobody would ever call because they feel like she's what? She's established and she's what? Real strong. Just like when Brother Williams teaches Sunday school, nobody would see the need to tell him that I really appreciate teaching.
Yeah.
Okay, well, everybody don't do it because I know that sometimes people come to me, you know, I preach most of the Sundays during the year, right? Mm-hmm. Not all of them, but very rarely you'll find anybody that will tell you that they ever get anything out of what you're saying, trying to say.
Yeah,
I say that very few. very, 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 very few. All right, now I'm going to tell you how important that is because General Petraeus,
yeah.
Okay, I wonder if somebody had admonished him to stay clean. And I see all of these women that this woman that's really having a real interest in being drawn, attracted to you. I said, well, be strong, General. Don't give in to those types of passes or whatever. If he had been admonished and warned, who knows how things would have turned out. He might have been able to what? To resist. So I think it's important for us to admonish and to minister to people even if they are doing well because you want them to continue what? To be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. So people have to be exhorted. They have to be encouraged or admonished. We need, no man is an island and no one can stand alone. We need the input, right? And we need the prayers and we need the support and we need the help of others. So we have a pretty big assignment because it extends much further than just taking care of ourselves. We are our brother's what? Keeper. And we have to be dead serious about what encouraging people, praying for people, supporting them, and really doing all that we can to get them deal up and established in grace. And who knows, one of these strong sisters or brothers that you think that don't need an ounce of encouragement, they might be at the verge of what? For getting off. You know, the devil, the Bible says he's as a roaring lion. I mean, everybody have these temptations and moments and the times that they go through things, and that sometimes they need additional strength and help, and they need to be admonished to what? To stand and to stay strong. Everybody goes through those periods. So that's the reason why the Lord said that we are the strong ought to what? Bear the infirmities of the weak and not please ourselves. Now, I'm just trying to get everybody with a firmer grip on the ministry and what the ministry is all about. We have more than we can do right here, even though we might not have 500 people. But we do have enough people that have enough needs that come to this church that really need to be what? Reached out to, that need personal attention. And they need it from not just me or the leaders, but they do need it from what? Individuals that worship in this church. So we need to know the names of everybody that comes here. Okay, if you can't remember, write it down. Call them. You call them. Tell them about the prayer book. That's usually the first thing that we try to get people doing, is doing confessions after they get saved or born again. And they don't even know that we even have one. Wouldn't it be wonderful if you broke the news to them? That we have something that can really get you strong, that can really get you established in the Word. We have a confession. The 20, is that 20, what you call it? 20, what do you call it?
Freedom
Truth. They haven't even heard of that. They don't even know that we have one. You know we got 20. See, there are a lot of simple things that we can do. Things like that we can share. That's the reason why we need to get their names and their phone numbers, and we need to connect with them. And this is how we get our ministry started. And if you talk with them long enough, you will know pretty well what they're up against, what they're dealing with, what challenges are going on in their life, and what conflicts they're having. And then you can always turn to the appropriate prayer, appropriate confession, and appropriate exhortation or whatever they need in order for them to, get beyond that. Now, another thing too, as I mentioned today, many times when people first come, the meditation book or the prayer book, we ask you all for $10 for that in order to put it together. When you get those books bound, it costs about $3 to get them bound. Then you have to pay for each sheet, each copy. Okay, if there's a whole lot of copies, that means they're what? Their price. And they usually charge about 50, about 10 cents per copy, 9 or 10 cents per copy. So you can see that a new person that just coming into the church, you would have a hard time just presented, so this will cost you $10. And they don't see the value of that, and they probably have never paid $10 for nothing when it comes to church material. So how do they get it? Somebody have to what? Sow it into their lives. See, you find out a lot of things that people need as you begin to what? Talk to them and begin to get acquainted with them. So We just don't want to just come here and just sit and go back home and hear and hear and hear and not get involved in people's lives. And sometimes people are out for two or three Sundays. And, you know, you want to try to figure out, it's not that difficult to figure out who didn't show up on Sunday evening. But if you miss a person, then I think it's appropriate for you to call and say, as Sister Marianne said, that just said that we really missed you. And then if you are listening to the preacher, you can just kind of share a little bit of what the preacher talked about. Okay, so we are not saved just to set out our time, a lot of time, when we're coming to church and sitting on these pews, but we're to be very actively involved in the life of people. So that's the reason why the scripture, let me turn to the scripture here, talks a lot about be filled with fruits of righteousness. Be careful to maintain good works. Bear much fruit. That's the scripture. Did we read that? The one that I want is Colossians 1:10. Because I mentioned Colossians 1:10. It says this, that for this cause we also, since the day we heard it, do not cease to pray for you. Okay, anybody see anything in that scripture that we can actually do? He ceased not to what? Pray for you. And I think that this is something that we can do. Once we begin to reach out and get to know people, I think that we can pray for them. And we can also, what, pray with them on the phone. Colossians 1:9. Since the day we heard it, do not cease to pray for you and to desire that ye might be what? Filled with the knowledge of his will and in all wisdom and spiritual understanding. That's probably the primary barrier that new people have. They do not understand spiritual things. So we have to pray with them, pray for them, that they may be filled with what? The knowledge of his will in all wisdom and spiritual understanding. So, Brother Travis, this is a good way for us to pray for these particular needs on prayer night. Pray that ye be what? Filled with the what? The knowledge of his will in all wisdom and spiritual understanding. So they need the knowledge and they need the wisdom that enables them to what? So apply that knowledge. And that just doesn't come just from coming to church. You have to what? Pray that the eyes of your understanding might be what? Enlightened. This is a real, real huge need that every person has. Even the members of this church, they need to what? Because everybody don't get it on the same level. There are different levels of what? Understanding the revelation that exists even among us. And that's the reason why we have to pray that the eyes of the understanding of believers will be what? Because they're not going to do any more than they what? They know to do. God has to what? Show it to them. You already know it, but God has to what? Show it to them. It's got to be revealed. You can tell them, but it's what? God has to what? Has to intervene. And okay, number 10, verse 10, that ye might walk worthy of the Lord unto all pleasing, being fruitful in every good work, and increasing in the knowledge of God. Walking worthy of the Lord unto all pleasing is just developing these fruits of the Spirit in your life. And the only way these fruits can be developed is to serve the Lord by sowing into the lives of people, loving people, ministering to them, being concerned about them, and doing things that you can do. A lot of things you can do can be done in terms of encouragement, teaching, exhorting them, things, truths you know, experiences that you've been through. You can share your testimony, and you can relate to people as you begin to know them on a level where you can really minister effectively to them. Now, when you began to do that, this is when these virtues really began to develop more and more. There's no way that you can really learn patience and be kind. There's no way you can just learn that just by not fooling with folk. I mean, patience and kind, long-suffering. I'm going to tell you, because a lot of times you're not going to even feel like picking up the phone. People call you, they want to talk a long time. Got to be what? Patient. And what? Long-suffering. And what? Kind. And when you go through that and be long-suffering, patient, and kind, that means what? That means that these fruits are what? Developing and coming in what? Into fruition. They're going to be what? Manifested more and more through your life. So ministry has to go along with spiritual development or character development in order for it to be manifest. You got to do both of them. You got to really get involved with people. And it's not a big issue. See, as long as we just kind of be in our own corner, live to ourselves, and the Bible says that the stronger, let no one please. Let me see, how does that go in Romans 13? Let me see, how does that go? Romans, I think somebody read that Sunday. I think Brother Walter read that. But I thought it was good. I guess that stuck in his mind. It says, we then that are strong. How many feel like if you've been in Northside for any period of time, you ought to be a little stronger than people that just what? Start coming. We then that are strong ought to bear the infirmities of the weak. Romans 15, verse 1. No, I said Romans 15. I said Romans. Okay, Romans. Okay, well, y'all should have known that was 15. All right. Okay, whenever I say we that are strong, you know that's Romans what, 15, verses 1. Y'all got it? You got it? Every time you hear me say it, it's still going to be found. Romans 15, verses 1 and 2. We that are strong are to what? Bear the infirmities of the weak, and not to what? Isn't it so much easier just to please ourselves? Don't mess with them. You ain't got time. Oh, you're so tired. Every man for himself, God for us all. Oh, we're blowing the opportunities to what? Grow in grace and in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. You're blowing it. And I don't care how hard you try. If you just come to Bible study and never reach out, never touch the lives, never sow into people's lives, never try to be involved in their spiritual development, you're just going to what? Grow. You'll grow, but it's not going to be the proper type of growth. Sometimes people just get real what? Boastful, proud. Oh, I've been in the way for 20 years. I've been in the way. Okay, now, let every one of us please his neighbor for his good to edification. Let every one of us please his neighbor. Neighbor is the person that needs help, person that immature, just start coming, people that really need the assistance of those that's what strong. They really, really need your assistance. And so We are not to please ourselves, but we are to please our neighbor for his good, to edification. For even Christ pleased not what? Himself. But as it is written, the reproaches of them are the abuses of them that abuse thee fell on me. So Christ suffered. I mean, all of this was laid on him. All of the sins and the contradictions, oppositions and the abuses and all of that, that was laid on Christ. So Christ didn't want that, but he didn't have no choice. In order for him to learn obedience, he had to what? Suffer. He had to be placed in a position where he could what? Bring redemption to the human race. Okay, back to that Colossians scripture. I want you to just see, it mentions being filled with the fruits of righteousness. Anybody get that? Being filled, let me see, maybe I got it wrong. Being fruitful in every what? Good work, and increasing in the knowledge of God, strengthened with all might according to his glorious power, unto all patience and long-suffering with joyfulness. So those are the fruit of a spirit that evolves or that manifests when we really begin to what reach out. And being fruitful is the part that we have to do in terms of not only developing those qualities, but we have to what serve. And this is the ministry aspect. How many know that we have been given the ministry of reconciliation and the word of reconciliation? We've been given that. That's our what? Purpose. To reconcile, to help reconcile the world to God. How many believe that? Reconciling the world. And this is how we reconcile people to God, bring them into harmony. We got to what? Touch their lives. Touch their lives. I remember last week it was our brother Mason. And he comes faithfully every Sunday. And Angela comes to the Wednesday Bible study, Wednesday morning. And I say that, I wonder if anybody have reached out to him and have anybody been able to locate him? What's going on with him? And is he filled with the Holy Ghost? Does he know for sure that he's saved? Are y'all ready to go? I'm not done. But this is ministry. And this is something that, what, we don't think is ministry. We think ministry just coming and listening to me or Brother Williams or Little Wayne on the fifth Sunday the women's have a beautiful program. Ooh, that's ministry. Ooh, brothers, second last week. Ooh, that's powerful ministry.
That's part of it.
It's part of it because, you know, you do minister to people's lives. But I think that the part that we overlook is what? The one-on-one. And everybody, you got a wealth of what? Information, knowledge, a wealth of strength, grace, that you can minister. All you have to do, watch this, all you have to do is just what? Talk to people. You find out what? Everything comes out. And then you can just tell them what you did. Okay, Sister Hill, is it time to go? Okay, so the Hill says that one more scripture, and it will be 10.
Oh, yeah, I'm going to have some announcements.
Okay. And this I pray, this is Philippians 1:9. These scriptures, all of them, 1:9, 1:9, 1:9, 1:9. But y'all should remember these, 1:9, 1:9, 1:9. All of these good scriptures. Okay, and this I pray that ye may abound yet more and more knowledge and in all. Now who's praying that prayer? Who's supposed to pray that prayer? Abound more and more in what? Love. needs what? Abound more and more in love. We got to find out what's going on with the people that God is sending. How, I mean, should God, you think God should send us 200 more? 300 more? When we don't even know the 10 that he has sent and they've been around for 3 months or 6 months? You don't even know their name? I mean, some of us might know some of their names, but this is the thing. I don't think it requires a whole lot of faith, boldness to what? Find out people's names and call them. Is there anything I can do? Any way I can help? Are there any questions? I'd like to share with you. I'd like to pray with you. I'd like to pray this prayer here with you, that you may abound more and more in love, increase in the knowledge of his will, the eyes of your understanding, being what in life. You can pick out a prayer out of the what? Prayer book, and pray it with them. And ask them if they have a prayer book, if they need one, or you can figure out how you can what get one to them. Y'all think that this ministry, that ministry,
yes,
is it needful?
Yes.
How can people make it without those basic? Okay, I got one. As I pray that your love may abound yet more and more in knowledge and in all judgment, that ye may approve things that are what? That ye may be what? Sincere and without offense till the day of Christ. So those are the virtues that he's talking about there. Then, being filled, watch that, being filled with the what? Fruits of what?
Righteousness.
All right. The Bible talks about what? Fruits. Not only character building fruit, but what? Fruits in which you actually get involved. You don't have to know how to teach a whole Bible lesson. You don't have to be 10 years into Bible study. You can just what? Do very simple things to help people to get rooted and established in the Lord. And so until we get people in these pews, all right, write that down. Get people in the pew. I'm listening. Get people in the pew. And do something about them that's in the pew.
Yes.
It's a whole lot of doings need to be done. That's a crazy to say. A whole lot of doings need to be done before this ministry can really spring forth and be established the way the Lord wants. You know, it's time to get off the sideline.
Yes.
There's a lot of ministry in this church. All right, so you talked about purpose tonight. That's the reason why God raised you up.
Yes.
Amen.